morning. Good deal.
Appreciate it.
Good morning. Glad you all join us in worship this morning. It's number 52 in the hymnal. You'll be on where Sam's got it, so you would.
Yeah.
just thank you that you lead us, that you guide us all through this life. Thank you for this beautiful day we have to worship you in this Thanksgiving week. We look forward to getting together with family, thanking you in a gathered sort of setting. We know we can thank you every single day for all of our many blessings. Thank you so much for providing salvation for us through Jesus Christ and leading us and guiding us until that day when we see him and it's coming. And we thank you so much for the hope that we have through him. We ask this in his name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Good to see you. Let's continue to worship.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am old. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on.
Take my hand.
Thank you all. You were a fantastic choir this morning. That was awesome. Greg, Brett, if you could help me distribute these handouts quickly. Thank you, man. It should be enough for everybody to have one, or at least each family to have one. Good to see you all this morning. Happy Thanksgiving. Blessings to you this week. Since June, we've been in the book of Proverbs in a series entitled, Welcome to Wisdom. Wisdom is God's way to life and God's way to live. Wisdom is more than knowledge. Wisdom is more than experience. Wisdom is more than common sense, but it includes all three. Wisdom is what God would do. Wisdom is God's will and God's way. We found that wisdom, God's wisdom, is revealed in His Word, and that man's wisdom is revealed by his response to God's Word. Whenever God speaks to you, what you do next reveals your wisdom or your lack of it. This morning, we're closing God's workbook on wisdom with a message entitled Wisdom for the Future, Proverbs 16:9. If you're not there, find it real quick. Proverbs 16:9 reminds us that none of us know the future, but we know God does. And like the old song, I don't know who holds tomorrow, but I know He holds my hand. So since we don't know the future and God does, it's wise for us to prepare for it. But Proverbs 16:9, and there are many verses in Proverbs I could have chosen for this particular theme this morning. Proverbs 16:9 says, a man's heart devises his way, but the Lord directs his steps. Let's just turn that proverb into a proverb. Let's look at it in two parts. Man devises, but God directs. There's always going to be that very mysterious but evident fact that we have a part to play in the future, but ultimately, the future belongs to God. Somebody said it this way. We should pray as if everything depends on God and work as if everything depends on us. And that's the balance that we always want to keep in check as we think about future things. We can't just be passive and say, whatever God wants, I guess He's going to do it. At the same time, we've got to be careful not to make plans that are out of God's will or out of His timing. So part of the future for Oak Grove Baptist Church is this thing we call refocus. And you have a handout there. One of these days, this church is going to move into a new season of service to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And refocus is part of the process of getting us there. The last few months, our vision team has been meeting with Bob Dickerson. Bob is the pastor of First Baptist Church of Marion. He's been leading us through the refocus process. And this morning, I just want to give you an update on where we're at and what's going on with that. I gave you an update the first Sunday in October, and this is update number two. So that front page just shows you the process again, for those of you that may have forgotten or maybe not seen that before. Refocus is what it says it is. I won't read that to you, but there's several steps or stages in the refocus process as the church determines the future, what to do, how to do it, so on and so forth. The discovery phase, now we've completed that. I talked to you about that last time, but let's review that. On the second page, you got that bell curve. And so looking at church history and statistics and all that stuff down through the past years, our vision team determined that in the life cycle of a congregation, every congregation goes through a life cycle. This congregation was founded in 1864, about a mile and a half up the road in a log structure that's no longer there. Before it moved here later on, we built this building. Well, this building was built in 1960. But in 1864, to now, a congregation will go through many cycles in their life. But we determined that we are in that area between treadmill and rut. And that's a prime time for any congregation to refocus, to revision, to review where they've been and where they need to go in the future. As I said the first time I talked about this, if you're a little more optimistic, you might say we're at the treadmill. If you're a little more pessimist, you might say we're at the rut. So let me introduce a third word that's very important in this whole process, and that's the word plateau. Plateau. 80% of Southern Baptist churches, including churches in Illinois, are plateaued or declining. Let that sink in. I don't use a lot of statistics, but I'm going to throw a few numbers out here for you. The Illinois Baptist State Association has approximately 900 churches and missions. 80% of those 900 or so are either plateaued or declining. They're either at the top end of that treadmill or they're down at the rut moving towards the death rattle, that direction. And that's a lot of churches. That's 720 churches in the state of Illinois that would fall into this plateau area. It's not bad to be in a plateau, but it's bad to realize it and not do anything about it. And unfortunately, that's what's going on in our state. There's only about 50 churches that are presently in the refocus process. So that means about 670 churches in the state of Illinois are in this plateau or decline, and they're just not doing anything about it. They're just thinking things are going to get better. They won't. They won't. But each church, every church, has some kind of future, at least for a while. So we're trying to do something about where we're at and where God wants us to go. We're seeking His plan for the future, and that, my brothers and sisters, is wise. So as a result of our first step or first stage, we came up with five core discoveries. That's on the back of your bell curve. We did the statistical studies, the histories, the ebb and flow. Times when this congregation was strong and growing, times when it was hurting and declining and different things like that. As we've come out of the pandemic, out of the holding pattern we've been in the pandemic, we found five core discoveries, things we need to be focusing on and seeking to do in the future. Number one, moving from a maintenance to a motivated ministry where more church members are involved, not just attenders, but active participants in the ongoing ministry of the future of the church. Number two, develop strategies to reconnect the disconnected. Now, a lot of people are disconnected. Everybody got scattered in different places after the pandemic. And getting people back together in a large group, in a small group setting, and then getting them involved in ministry is a big part of the future for any church. We're just talking about ours. Number three, find ways to increase Bible study participation. And then seek God about a signature ministry. That is, one ministry that the church can focus on, whether that be the preschool ministry or a senior adult ministry or a youth ministry or whatever that would be, something that this church would be known for, people would unite around. We saw that was an important discovery for this church. Instead of just maybe doing all kinds of different things but never doing anything. No focus. And then initiate a revitalization of vision, purpose, and mission. We'll talk about that more in just a minute, because that's what we're doing. So that's what I shared with you the last time we got together. Where we were in the last cycle of congregation, some of the basic discoveries. Now on the front page, we moved through discovery, we move through convergence, and you see there's three statements there on convergence that are important: church purpose, leadership passion, and community potential. So we've looked at the purpose of the church, which is basically grounded in the Bible, and if we know what that is, to make disciples, say more about that in just a minute. The passion of leaders, what do we need to focus on as far as leaders and leading the church to follow Jesus? And then what about our community? What about old Pinckneyville, the friendly little city? You know, what are the needs there? What are some things that we can address as we reach out and seek to be relevant to people who need to know Jesus? So those are the things we looked at in the convergence. And then we move now into the pyramid. We're not through with the pyramid, but we moved into that. And you see the various parts of that pyramid: mission, strategy, values, vision, plans, and goals. So what I want to share with you this morning is the mission and the values. We've completed those, and that's on these last two pages of your handout. Also, if you would take your Bibles and find the book of Matthew and the book of Acts, that would be helpful, because I'm going to refer to them in just a minute. Bless you. Now again, all of these are potential. We're not even proposing these to be considered, to be adopted, to be voted on. This is not a business meeting. This is just informational. We're just working through this process. We don't know how long the process is going to take. Many more months, for sure. The first of the year, until we come up with a finished plan that then we'll present to the church and adopt if the church is willing to do that. So, the mission of the church. We know Matthew 28, 18 through 20, we commonly call that the what? Great Commission. Jesus said, go into all the world, that includes our little world, and make disciples of all nations, fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ. That begins, of course, with bringing people to saving faith, where they make a confession of faith, they accept Christ, they're baptized, and then we begin to teach them or instruct them, and of course we have different things going on at the church to do that, different opportunities for that. Everybody agrees that that is the mission of the church, but how will each individual local church do that? Our church is different than First Baptist. First Baptist is different than the Methodist, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Each local church that names Jesus as Lord has different people, different giftings, different opportunities, and God is leading all those churches to follow him. So, our mission statement, you see it there, has a tagline: living God's love. Now, if you've been around here for a while, you know, for a long time, sort of our tagline has been, there's hope here. It's on the stationery and stuff like that. So this would be a little bit different if we go this route. But the mission statement that we've developed for talking purposes is a community living God's love by growing together and reaching others in faith, hope, and love through Jesus Christ. And then you see the scripture passage. That's the big two. Do you realize the first commandment in the Bible, the most important, is about love? And do you realize the second commandment that's most important is also about love? So this love thing is a big deal. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. So that's the vertical aspect of loving God and the horizontal aspect of loving other people. So by using that particular passage of Scripture, we're defining the mission of the church to be love-driven. Love is the engine. Love is the transmission. Without love, we're not going anywhere as a congregation. So we are a community, that's us, community of faith, living God's love. And then there's the internal aspect, growing together and reaching others. There's the external aspect. Or we would say the gathered and the scattered. There's times when we come together, and there's times when we separate and go apart. And then faith, hope, and love. If you know anything about the New Testament, especially Paul's writings, when you think about measuring how is a church doing, we often use nickels and noses, you know. We often look at those things. We look at how many people attended or what's the budget look like or whatever. The Bible never talks about that one time. Although it's important. Don't misunderstand me. It's important. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad we got some money. But the Bible says faith, hope, and love. Now those aren't as quantitative as they are qualitative measurements of a fellowship. But faith, hope, and love are the three eternal things. 1 Corinthians 13. And stay with me, class. The greatest of these is love. There you go. So you see how this love thing comes together. So if we had a business card or stationery, it'd say Oak Grove Baptist Church, Living God's Love. So everything needs to be run through that mission. Now on the back it tells you what a mission statement does. I'm not going to go through all that, but that would be important for you to look at. The mission basically says what? What we do. This is what we do. You go to a hospital, a lot of times on the wall you'll see a mission statement. You go to a certain kind of business or a college or whatever, you'll see a mission statement. This place exists for fill in the blank. So what we're saying with the mission statement is something that's simple, practical, theological, it's portable, it's memorable, probably some other bulls that I can't think of right now. But there it is, okay? So the mission statement is a broad, brief declaration of what the church is to be doing. Now, just having a mission statement, whether it's this one or another one, and adopting a mission statement, whether it's this one or another one, doesn't necessarily mean it's getting done. So just having something is only the beginning. And we'll say more about that as time goes by. So that's the mission statement. Now turn to Acts chapter 2. Another key component in refocus and church identity is our values. Now, what values are is the things that are important. Sometimes we use the word priorities, but priorities and values are different. Values are the deep things. You can say you got certain priorities, but what you do is your values. So we developed a values statement based on our church, our different generations, different activities, ministries, etc. And we found these were the top five values in our fellowship. Now, if you look at Acts chapter 2, verse 42 through 47, I'm just going to talk about it while you look at it. We see some of the values of the very first church. This is the church in Jerusalem. Remember, Jesus went up. He said, you're going to wait till you get empowered by the Holy Spirit, and then you're going to go out. And they did. They're on the day of Pentecost. Acts chapter 2, Peter preached a great sermon. Others were witnessing, about 120 of them. And 3,000 Jewish people became believers in Yeshua, the Messiah, Jesus Christ. So they began to gather. This is the first church. And if you look down through those verses, you'll see things. They had the apostles' doctrine, a teaching, Bible study, those types of things. That was important then. That was one of their values. We see prayer in there. That was important. Fellowship, being together, that was important to them. Down there towards the bottom, it says praising God, worship. So you can kind of look through there and see things that they did in first century Jerusalem that were important, that gave them a congregational identity, the sense of community. This is what we do here. This is important to us. Obviously, we can't do everything that's important to everyone. But what we've come up here is these five basic values that define what our congregation, our fellowship, our church thinks is important. We need to focus on. Number one, family. Now, that not only includes your family, but it includes our family, the family of God. We believe in helping families grow together spiritually with our church family. So you see, here we are, and we're thinking about others that we can reach and connect and make them part of our church family. So that's a value for us. Of course, God began with family. That's the building block of any society, is the family. What's being just attacked mercilessly by the devil? The family. And so that could be a big point of us developing ministries to help families and strengthen them and also bless the church. Number two, teaching. Obviously, preaching from the pulpit, small groups. Say more about that in a minute. We've got different groups and different groupings. We've done that for years and years and years. Teach the Bible. Learn the Bible. Grow in your faith. So we believe in teaching people to observe everything Jesus has commanded. That comes right out of the Great Commission, Matthew 28, 18 through 20. Number three, worship is a value. We believe in loving God personally, personal worship, and together as a church family, gathered worship through praising and preaching. Of course, we know there's more than that, but that's the basic things we do together in a worship environment, our worship experience. Number four, prayer. We believe in communicating with God daily on a personal basis, at my own life, small groups. We have prayer groups that meet in different ways at different times, and as a congregation. Of course, as long as I've been the pastor here, even before that, when I was a young guy going to church here, prayer has always been a big part of this church, and it should be a big part of every church. That's the fuel, you might say, that drives the engine that's low. And then number five, outreach. We believe in going out into the community to share encouraging words of hope, welcome, and a plan for them, that's people on the outside, to become part of our church family. So it starts with family and ends with family. That's how that all comes together. Now, what values are is on the back. Again, I won't read all that to you, but values tell why. Mission tells what. This is what we do. So somebody said, what do you do out there at that church? Well, this is what we do. Here's our mission statement. Why do you do that? There's a value statement. We value people and teaching the Bible and worshiping together, etc., etc., etc. That becomes part of our congregational identity. So the mission statement and the value statement, what we do and why we do what we do, becomes very important. I don't want to go too far with this because I could dump the truck on you and you'd have to climb out. I don't want to do that. I don't want to overload you with information this morning. But as you know, increasingly in the United States of America, people are less Christian and more pagan, especially as they get younger. So to be able to have a way to communicate with people who don't know God or who have very little biblical memory, and that's increasing in the world as well, helps us to become what missionaries call contextualized. To be able to reach out from where we are, our context, and the people out here who don't know anything about Christ, the Bible, God's ways, that sort of thing. So what a mission and value statement does is it helps us to verbalize to others who we are, why we exist, and why we want them to come and be part of our church family by having a relationship with the Lord, number one, and then connecting with his church family, number two. Now, December the 1st, that's a Thursday, write that down, I think it's in the bulletin, if not, write it down. At 6 p.m. will be your opportunity to come and dialogue with the vision team. We'll meet out here in the fellowship hall, that's December the 1st, Thursday night, 6 p.m. Maybe you've got some input, maybe you've got some insight, maybe you've got some questions, maybe you just want to know more information. So we want to take time to meet with anybody and everybody who would like to just participate in an informal, casual dialogue about what we're doing. I don't want anybody to ever think this is Brother Rob's idea or the vision team is just going to make us do this. We want this to be a dialogue, okay? So I want to open this up on the 1st of December for anybody that would like to come. And then our vision team members will be there. We'll interact and get some insights or questions from you. If you can't be there, you want to write some things down and get those to me, we'll consider those as well. Again, this is a process. It's going to take some time for us to reach what I consider to be a map to the future. By the way, that picture there, that's Monument Valley in Utah. I don't know if you can see it, but it just goes and goes and goes. But when you get way up there to the top, it starts to veer off. Can you see that? That's what happened to me in 2019 when I was first praying about the future. I turned 60, and all of a sudden, I saw that bend in the road for the first time in my life. It was quite threatening. All my life, was just a straight highway. Going to serve God. The Lord said, no, it's going to bend at some point, Rob. You're not going to live forever. You're not going to be the pastor forever. And that's where that all started. And I found that picture. And everybody's road is going to bend at some point. But God's still on the other side of that mountain. And he wants this church to have a great witness and testimony off until we get on the other side of that mountain as well. So, if you'd like to come be part of that dialogue on December the 1st at 6 p.m., we'd love to have you. Now, take your bulletin, your church bulletin, and turn back to the book of Proverbs, chapter 27. So, we're doing this thing called refocus, thinking about the future. But just because we're in refocus doesn't mean we're going to lose focus. So let's talk about, from our bulletin, what we're doing now. We're not talking about this, we're not praying about this, we're not planning this, plotting this, strategizing this. These are things that are ongoing now that all of us can pray about and participate in now. On the back side, you've got all the activities. Bible studies Sunday morning for every age group. If you're not in a Bible study and you'd like to be in one, there is one. We'd love to have you. If you have any questions about that, talk to me or I'll put you in touch with one of the teachers. Other than children, teenagers, adults, they're all there. We'd like to start some more groups. And they may not meet on a Sunday morning. They could meet on other nights. We've got some things going on Sunday night there, too, as you can see. The men's group meets on Wednesday nights. That's been a great group, especially for me. I need that. We all need to find ways to grow in our faith, to grow in our hope, to grow in our love. And so hopefully you'll look at some of those things, and if you're not a participant, you would want to check some of those things out. Now, we have the prayer group that meets on Wednesday mornings. That's a great thing. If we want to start a prayer group on another night, we could do that. If somebody's interested in that. I'm always looking for new things to start up. I love that. Then we started our Salt and Light ministry. You see the three different locations we've been going to for a little over a month now. Have different people in those places doing different things. And if you'd like to be involved in that, if you're not working through the day, you'd like to check one of those things out, we'd love to have you. Basically, the nursing home, it's music and encouragement. And at the housing complexes, it's Bible study and prayer and getting to meet people and trying to be a blessing. Salt and light. Jesus said, you're the salt of the earth, you're the light of the world. He said, but you can't keep salt in the shaker, you can't keep your light under a bushel. You got to let it shake and you got to let it shine. So those are there. We could start up other outreach ministries if you have an idea. And if you just get before the Lord and begin to pray and say, God, what would you have me to do in this present season in our church? There are things there. If you'd like to help with the preschool, talk to Miss Trish. They meet 9 to 11 on Tuesdays and Thursdays. We've been doing the preschool for many, many years now. I feel like it would be a great point of contact with unsaved or unchurched young people for the future of this church, but that's just me. I could be wrong about that. I was wrong twice on Thursday. But those are there. We're doing those things now. And that's important. On the inside, we got the security team. I'm going to talk to Jeremy about that. Parking lot, security ministry, meeting people, greeting people as they come in, guiding them, leading them, making that connection. The welcome team, you talk to Sherry about that. Some of you have been serving on the welcome team for some time. I'd like to expand some of those things in the new year. And children and youth ministry, you see that there as well. So, these are listed every week so that you can see them and ask God about what you might like to be part of. Those are things we're doing now. Again, refocus doesn't mean we're going to lose focus. We want to be about inviting people to Jesus, getting people back into the church, getting in deeper. And the best way to make disciples is what? Be one. Be one.
Be one.
So if you take the next steps to being involved in a group or being involved in serving, then you have a great platform, a spiritual platform, to encourage others to come along and help you. If you're not, then you're probably not going to encourage anybody to do anything. And I don't mean that bluntly, but that's how it usually works out. So, refocus what we're doing now. Finally, Proverbs 27:1. Now, there's many passages in the book of Proverbs we could use for thinking about the future, wisdom for the future. We've all got a future. Church has got a future. But it's wisdom to prepare for the future. Man devises, God directs. Proverbs 27:1 says, do not boast about tomorrow, for you don't know what a day may bring forth. I have a funeral tomorrow. I have a funeral on Tuesday. A year ago this week, I preached two funerals for my father-in-law, one in Kentucky and one in West Virginia. 8 years ago this month, I preached my own wife's funeral right here on this platform. Nobody's going to live forever. We don't know how long we've got left. It is wisdom to not presume on the future, but it is also wisdom to prayerfully plan for the future. And that's what I want to get across to you this morning. There's a delicate balance where if we seriously want God to bless our church and to lead us in the future, we've got to prepare. We've got to position ourselves. We've got to pray. We've got to seek God and ask Him what we need to be doing. And then we've got to shuck everything else and get in line with Him. We've got to adjust to His plan and His future if we want our church to be blessed in the future. Unfortunately, as I said, a lot of churches in Illinois are just hoping things will get better. They want the churches to go back to the way it used to be. The way we were, church. Remember that song by Barbara Streisand, that movie, The Way We Were? That's what a lot of people want. Hey, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. Some of the things we've done in the past, we'll continue to do in the past. Some we will not, as God leads and as we obey Him. But the future is coming, and it's going to be different than any of us can imagine. But God's there, and He wants us all to be participants in that future. So I just wanted to share this wisdom for the future this morning. Thinking about the inevitable end of all things, life and our opportunities, and trying to make the most of the time we've got left to serve the Lord and to be in a position in the future when somebody else stands in this spot and there's a plan and a purpose for the church for that person to plug into and lead the church forward as well. That's my goal and desire in all of this, is to have the church in the best place possible when God begins to move into that future. All right. Allison's going to come and play the piano for us in just a minute. We're going to observe the Lord's Supper again, December the 1st. Write that on your calendar if you'd like to come and participate in that dialogue. We'd love to have you. Take your hymnal and turn to the back of the hymnal. There's something we call responsive readings. And we're going to participate in a responsive reading. And she's going to come and play while the guys distribute the elements of the Lord's Supper this morning. Responsive reading number 698. 698. I'll read the light type, and if you will read the dark type, we'll work through this together. Number 698, the Lord's Supper. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he brake it and said,
Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me.
After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me.
For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death until he come.
Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord.
But let every man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup.
For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body.
Now unto the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory forever and ever.
Father, we bow before you and prepare our hearts for the table, the observance of the supper. As a church family, our mission, the Great Commission to reach others and then to baptize them. And then once they become part of a fellowship, the ongoing table reminding us of the great price that's been paid for us to be part of this thing the Bible calls the church, the family. As we examine our hearts this morning, Lord, help us not only to be ever mindful of the price that was paid, but that the price has been paid, and that we can rejoice as we come to the table. Not just a point of repentance if we need to, if we need to confess something, deal with some issue, but also a table of rejoicing that looks forward to the Lord's return. He said, as often as you do this, you proclaim my death until I come. And so we know as we move into the future, at some point, Lord, you're coming. And we thank you for the hope that that gives us, the hope of heaven that lies straight ahead for those in Christ. So as we observe this morning, Lord, help us to repent, if need be, and to rejoice in the fact that our sins are forgiven and we belong to you. And nothing can change that. Father, we do thank you and love you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
I'm just going to play. The guys are going to distribute. And when you take your elements, it's on you this morning. Whatever you feel you should participate, do that. As she plays, as we worship, you do that. Each one in his own way, in his own time. That's how we'll do it this morning.